Now let us examine tri-butyl toride. It's a hydrolysis once again in a tri-butyl toride, which is called the substrate, that is the reacting organic molecule. The chlorine atom is replaced by OH group, and the first step is the slow hydrolysis of the CCl bond, giving a carbocation. And in tri-butyl toride, the carbon atom connected to chlorine is sp3 hybridized, whereas in the carbocation, the positive carbon is sp2 hybridized. So there is a change in hybridization, and this is a slow step, that is hydrolysis of CCl bond is a slow step. Now that is also called a rate determining step, because the overall rate of reaction is approximately equal to the rate of the slowest step. Now after the formation of carbocation, it is attacked by OH negative, which is called a nucleophile. Then we get the corresponding alcohol called a tri-butanol, that is step 2, and step 1, that is hydrolysis. Now let us examine the free energy diagram for the entire reaction. Now along this path, the CCl bond stretches, and during stretching the length increases, and as length increases, potential energy increases. So as length increases, potential energy increases. Now as Cl minus is gradually getting formed, then carbon acquires a positive charge, and initially the Cl gets a delta negative charge and carbon gets a delta positive charge. Now this delta positive charge of carbon can be stabilized by the hyperconjugation and the inductive effects of the methyl group. So the developing charge is stabilized by hyperconjugation and the inductive effect of the methyl group. And as the CCl bond stretches, there is increase in potential energy because the length increases. So two opposing factors, that is decrease in potential energy due to stabilization of the positive charge by the inductive and the hyperconjugation of methyl groups, and the increase in potential energy due to stretching of CCl bonds. Now the graph shows an increase. This is because initially the decrease in potential energy or free energy due to inductive and hyperconjugation effects of the methyl groups is lesser than the increase in potential energy due to stretching of the CCl bond. But as the stretching increases, the partial positive charge over this carbon increases, and the stabilization due to hyperconjugation and inductive effect of methyl group increases. When we reach a transition state 1, the stabilization due to inductive and hyperconjugation effects on the partial positive charge developed in the transition state is exactly equal to the increase in potential energy due to stretching of CCl bond. So once again, in the transition state, that is TS1, the decrease in potential energy due to stabilization of the positive charge, partial positive charge created on carbon by inductive and hyperconjugation is exactly equal to the increase in potential energy due to the stretching of CCl bonds. So transition state 1 is given by this structure. Now after the formation of transition state 1, the graph shows a decrease in free energy. This is because the partial positive charge over carbon 1 is now very high, say 0.7 or 0.8, so that the decrease in potential energy due to increased stabilization of the positive charge by by inductive and hyperconjugation increases in magnitude than the increase in potential energy due to stretching of CCL bond. So there is a decrease in free energy because there is a greater stabilization of the positive charge, partial positive charge over carbon by inductive and hyperconjugation effects, and there is a greater decrease in free energy, and this decrease in free energy has a magnitude higher than the increase in free energy due to stretching of CCL bonds. Now at the point I, the intermediate, that is carbocation, is formed, so carbon acquires a full positive charge, and that there it's a minimum in the graph. Then in the second step, the attack by OH negative on C positive occurs. Initially a very stretched bond is formed, and then there is a little neutralization of the positive charge over carbon from the negative charge of OH negative, which is the nucleophile, and that step is a fast step. Now as positive charge over carbon decreases, the stabilization due to hyperconjugation and inductive effect also decreases. So as the stabilization decreases, potential energy increases. Now initially the bond is in a stretched condition, and so the decrease in stability or increase in potential energy becomes more important. And increase in potential energy occurs because of the decreasing stabilization of the partial positive charge formed over the initially full positive carbon. So the inductive and hyperconjugation effects gradually decrease as the extent of positive charge decreases on the positive carbon by injecting electron density from OH negative towards the positive carbon. So the decrease in stability or increase in potential energy becomes important along this portion of the graph. Now when it reaches the transition state, the increase in potential energy due to decreasing stability, due to decreasing plus psi and hyperconjugation effects of the medial loop, just equals the decrease in potential energy due to shortening of the COH bond. So as COH bond approaches C positive, initially a stretched bond is formed, but that decreases in length, and as the length decreases, the potential energy also decreases. So the initial decrease tends to, initial increase tends to a decrease here. So at the transition state 2, we have the decrease in potential energy due to decreasing the positive charge over carbon by, of course, the inductive and hyperconjugation effects. The decrease in potential energy is exactly equal to the increase in potential energy is exactly equal to the decrease in potential energy due to shortening of CO bond in the transition state, and beyond this point there is a gradual decrease, showing that the bond formation becomes important than the stabilization of the positive charge, because the magnitude of positive charge decreases too much, so that the stabilization of the positive charge by inductive and hyperconjugation becomes less important. So beyond the transition state, we can say the decrease in potential energy due to decreasing length becomes more in magnitude than the decrease in stability or stabilization of the positive charge by inductive and hyperconjugation mechanism. So during decreasing charge, the potential energy increases because the magnitude of stabilization by hyperconjugation and inductive effect decreases. and that increase in potential energy, that magnitude of that increase in potential energy is lesser than the decrease in potential energy due to formation of bond or a shortening of bond between C and O. And finally, we get the product. Now, one speciality of TS1 and TS2 is that TS2 is of lower energy than TS1. Now, this is because in the transition state, the C-Cl bond is longer than C-O bond. So, shorter the length of the bond, lower is the potential energy or free energy. And this is because chlorine atom is providing an sp3 hybrid orbital belonging to the third shell, and since it belongs to a higher shell, it is having a longer length, and oxygen atom is providing an sp3 hybrid orbital belonging to the second shell. Since it belongs to a lower shell, the length of the sp3 hybrid orbital will be shorter, and so a shorter bond in the transition state as well as in the ground state. So CO bond here will be of shorter length than CCl bond. Now let us consider two examples. One is para tertiary butyl benzyl chloride reacting with NaOH. Cl is replaced by OH, and SN1 reaction to get the corresponding alcohol, reaction 1. And then paramethyl benzyl chloride with NaOH, corresponding alcohol, reaction number 2. Now, in the transition state for reaction number 1, there is stabilization of the positive charge by mesomeric effect of the benzene ring, whereas inductive effect of tertiary butyl group can reach only up to the third carbon, 1, 2 and third carbon. Beyond third carbon, the inductive effect dies away or becomes practically zero. Whereas in the transition state for paramethyl benzyl chloride, the partial positive charge is shared by or stabilized by hyperconjugation from the methyl group. This CH bond shifting in this direction partially, this pi bond shifting in this direction partially, and this pi bond shifting in this direction partially, so that this delta positive is transferred to this hydrogen. So hydrogen becomes delta positive, and there are three such hydrogen atoms, so that there is an additional stabilization of paramethyl benzyl chloride. In both these examples, the transition state is stabilized by the mesomeric effect of the benzene ring. That is common, but inductive effect cannot stabilize the transition state in this compound, whereas the methyl group can stabilize the transition state by hyperconjugation. So there is extra stabilization of the transition state for paramethyl benzyl chloride. So transition state 1, which is the transition state involved in the rate determining step that decides the speed of the overall reaction, the rate determining step. So in the rate determining step, there is extra stabilization of the transition state by the hyperconjugation of methyl group, whereas here there is no hyperconjugation and inductive effect cannot go beyond the carbon. So we say the transition state for this paramethyl benzyl chloride will be having a lower energy and consequently a lower free energy of activation, a lower free energy of activation. Now for an SN1 reaction, rate is given by K into concentration of Rx. Rx is the substrate here. Rx can be paramethyl benzyl chloride or para tertiary butyl benzyl chloride. And now K is called rate constant, and Rx within square bracket indicate concentration of substrate. and substrate is the reacting organic molecule. Now in the second equation, rate constant K equals A by E raised to EA by RT, and A is a constant. EA is called the free energy of activation, R is gas constant, and T is absolute temperature. Now what we are concerned more here is EA, that is energy of activation. Now energy of activation, the diagram is given by delta F, both are same. Now in this equation, K is equal to A by E raised to EA by RT. As EA decreases, EA by RT decreases, and E raised to EA by RT decreases, so that A by this quantity increases, A by a lower quantity. So value of A by E raised to EA by RT increases as EA decreases, so that K increases as EA decreases. So rate increases as K increases when the concentration of the substrate is a constant. So when we take equal concentrations of para tertiary butyl benzyl chloride and para methyl benzyl chloride, and we take equal concentrations of these two compounds, then rate is equal to K into concentration of Rx. Rate depends only on the factor K, because the concentration of Rx in both cases is the same, it's a constant. So rate increases as K increases, and K increases as EA decreases. So the reaction which possesses a lower energy of activation has a higher rate. And here we find that since transition state for paramethyl benzyl chloride is stabilized by hyperconjugation, its energy of activation is lower. So this reaction is faster than this reaction. Now the comparison of the rates or speeds of these two reactions show that hyperconjugation has got upper hand over inductive effects. So hyperconjugation is more important than inductive effects. Now coming to another electronic effect, that is electromeric effect. Now electromeric effect is a temporary effect. The effects which we have discussed so far, that is inductive effect, hyperconjugation effect, and mesomeric effect, all these effects are permanent effects, means these effects are present in the molecule along with its formation. A normal newly born baby will have almost all its organs. Similarly, a newborn compound will have all these effects inherent in it. Electromeric effect, on the other hand, is a temporary effect, and this effect occurs during a reaction under the requirement of the attacking reagent. Now, an attacking reagent can be an electrophile E positive or a nucleophile E negative. Now, suppose you are sitting in your study room in the middle of the room, and there is a window on the left hand side and another window on the right hand side. Suppose a friend of yours approaches the left hand side window, you stand up and go near the window, chat with him for some time, then come back, sit and continue study. Suppose the friend is approaching from the right hand side window, you stand up and go near the window, chat with him for some time, then come back and sit down and continue your study. So electromeric effect is something similar to that example. Suppose there is a C double bond C system. An electrophile suppose approaches from this side, that is right hand side, then this pi bond will be shifting over this carbon, means the electron pair in this bond will be going into the orbital of this carbon, creating a positive charge here and a negative charge here. When the electrophile leaves the field of the compound, then it returns back to the original condition, so the reaction is reversible. So when the electrophile is removed from the sphere of the reaction, then the lone pair becomes a bond pair. Lone pair becomes a bond pair, and we get back the alkene. Suppose the electrophile is approaching from the left hand side here, then due to its positive charge, the electron pair in the pi bond is attracted by this carbon. So shift of this pair of electron into the orbital of this carbon gives a negative charge here and positive charge here. And when the electrophile leaves the sphere, then the negative charge shifts back into its original position, and we get back the alkene structure. Then suppose a nucleophile is approaching from the right hand side, then since it is having a negative charge, the pair of electron will be shifting in opposite direction, so that we get carbon negative here and positive here. And when the electron when the nucleophile is removed from this side, the electron pair shift occurs like this, and the alkene structure is retained. Next, the nucleophile is approaching from the left hand side, then the electron pair shift occurs away from it, so we get negative here and positive here. And when the nucleophile is removed from the side, it returns back to the original structure, double bonded structure. Now examples for some electrophiles: H positive, Cl positive, Br positive, and a neutral molecule like sulfur trioxide. This one can act as an electrophile, because when SO bond polarizes in this direction, that means the pair of electron in the pi bond goes into the orbital of oxygen. Oxygen gets a negative charge, and sulfur gets a vacant orbital and a positive charge, and then this can approach just like E positive, because there is a vacant orbital and a positive charge. Then nitronium ion, NO2 positive, it's a linear ion like carbon dioxide molecule, because N positive and carbon has the same number of electrons. N positive nitrogen has 7 electrons, and N positive has 6 electrons, and carbon also has 6 electrons. So carbon dioxide and nitronium ion are isoelectronic, having similar structure. Then NO bond polarizes, the pi bond polarizes or ionizes like this. Oxygen gains a negative charge, then a vacant orbital and 2 positive charges. So nitronium ion can act as an electrophile due to its positive charge, of course, and providing a vacant orbital if the reaction proceeds further. The nucleophiles examples are OH negative, Cl negative, and the neutral molecules like ammonia and water can act as nucleophiles, because they have lone pairs, and they can donate these lone pairs towards the reaction site, so they can act as nucleophiles. So much about electromeric effect, less important. Now coming to steric effects. Now consider there a fan which is rotating at high speed. Now you cannot see the leaves of the fan. If you are taking a photograph, then you will see only a disc. We can say that the leaves of the fan are somewhere inside the disc, but we cannot exactly locate the position of the leaf or leaves in the disc. Similarly, an electron moving around the nucleus in an atom, the electron is moving around the nucleus in an atom with a velocity nearly 1 by 10th the velocity of light, so a tremendous speed. So when electron is moving around the nucleus in an atom, it is moving with a very high speed. And suppose you take a photograph of this atom, suppose you are able to take a photograph of this atom, then you will see only a cloud. If it is a hydrogen atom, you will see only a spherical cloud-like thing. A spherical cloud will be seen. You know, a cloud has no definite sharp boundary. Then a cloud will be denser at some point and will be having a lower density at some other point. Now we say the electron moving around the nucleus, electron or electrons moving around the nucleus, is something like a cloud, and this is called electron cloud. So electron cloud means it is electron itself, but we feel that, or we find that, since it is moving at a very high speed, it is probable everywhere in the spherical region. Since it is moving at a very high speed, the photograph will be seen as a cloud, and this is called electron cloud. And we can consider electron cloud as the orbital itself if it is a single atom, or if it is a group of atoms, then again we can speak of electron cloud. It is a combination of orbitals of different atoms. Anyway, the concept of electron cloud is more important than the concept of orbital when we consider a group, a collection of atoms. Now around this electron cloud, there is a region where the negative field is felt. So this is the electron cloud. The inner circle represents the electron cloud, which is spherical for a single atom. And around this cloud, there is another spherical region where the negative field of the electron is felt. Now when such an atom is present in a molecule, comes in contact with another atom which is not directly bonded to it, if they come closer, then the fields can repel each other, increasing the potential energy of the system. So suppose in a molecule, an atom with its field comes in contact with another atom which is not directly bonded to the first atom, and if their fields come closer enough, then they can repel each other. Now there is a parameter called van der Waals radius. Consider a chlorine molecule, a Cl-Cl molecule, Cl bond Cl molecule. Now A is the nucleus of one chlorine atom and B is the nucleus of another chlorine atom. Then this distance AB is called the bond length of the molecule. Now suppose another molecule of chlorine comes near the first molecule, then the surrounding field will repel each other, so then they cannot come much closer. So this is, we can say, the distance of closest approach. So BC is called the distance of closest approach. Now half the distance of BC is called van der Waals radius, BC by 2. So we can again say that the molecules cannot approach beyond a particular distance due to repulsion between the fields. Now half the distance BC is called van der Waals radius in the case of chlorine molecule, and this is half the distance of closest approach, that is called van der Waals radius. And whenever the groups or atoms in a molecule which are not directly bonded to each other approaches such that their van der Waals radii overlap, then repulsion can arise. This particular repulsion is called steric repulsion, and this effect is called steric effect. So steric effect operates when The van der Waal radii of non-bonded atoms or groups overlap. So steric effect operates when the van der Waal radii of non-bonded atoms or groups in a molecule overlap. When the radii overlap, the wheels repel each other and the molecule is strained. So during repulsion, what happens is that potential energy or free energy is increased and stability is decreased. So repulsion causes increase in potential energy and decrease in stability. Now consider two molecules, two isomeric molecules. They are cis-2-butene and trans-2-butene. Now in cis-2-butene, the two methyl groups are on the same side of the double bond. Now methyl group is a space consuming group, we say. It requires some space to occupy so that its field will have a definite volume. And this methyl group also has a field around it, so that the van der Waal radii of these two methyl groups come closer or they slightly overlap. And a C double bond C is a shorter bond than a C single bond C. So due to the shorter length of this double bond, there is repulsion between, steric repulsion between these two methyl groups. And due to repulsion, these groups will try to move apart. These two groups will try to move apart. That means the carbon-carbon bond length will be slightly increased. And bond length, as bond length increases, potential energy increases. Now there may happen that this methyl group, when the moving apart, this bond angle may decrease. This bond angle may decrease when these groups repel and try to move apart. And when this bond angle decreases, these two bonds come closer, these two bonds come closer, and the electron pair in the bonds may repel each other. So that repulsion can increase the potential energy or free energy and increase the instability. Then this effect is called the steric effect. So the increase in bond length causes a strain, an increase in potential energy, and that increase in potential energy due to increase in bond length is called a bond strain due to stretching of bonds. Again, angle strain due to shortening of bond angle. Now all these factors will make this structure unstable. So cis-2-butene is unstable, whereas in trans-2-butene the methyl groups are as far apart as possible. So there is no steric repulsion in trans-2-butene, so it is more stable. So when you are asked why cis-2-butene is less stable than trans-2-butene, you simply say that steric effect between methyl groups in cis-2-butene makes the molecule unstable. Steric repulsion between methyl groups makes the molecule unstable. There is steric repulsion in cis-2-butene between methyl groups, whereas in trans-2-methane, since the two methyl groups are far away, there is no steric repulsion. Now, a group with a large size is called a bulky group, having a large size. Tertiary butyl group is bulkier than methyl group because tertiary butyl group contains three methyl groups connected to a carbon. So, total of 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons are there. So, it's a butyl group. It is called a tertiary butyl group. Why? Because this carbon atom is directly bonded to three other carbons, hence tertiary carbon. Tertiary butyl group is bulkier than methyl group, so that this molecule is very highly unstable due to overlap of the van der Waal radii. And hence this compound, this is a cis compound, is much more unstable than this one. Now in tertiary butyl chloride, the three methyl groups, and there is one chlorine here, chlorine is a large group, the three methyl groups directed in the backward direction can cause steric repulsion among them. And since it is on the back side of chlorine, it is called the B strain or back strain. When the CCl bond ionizes, we get the carbocation. Where the bond angle is 120 degree, whereas this bond angle is 109 degree, nearly 109 degree. So there is a widening of bond angle when the CCl bond is ionized during SN1 reaction. So when this chlorine is ionized and we get a carbocation, this carbocation is sp2 hybridized, so bond angle is 120 degree. So there is an increase in bond angle from 109 degree to 120 degree, so that the methyl groups are a little more separated. So steric interaction between, steric repulsion between methyl groups is less in the case of the carbocation than in the substrate TC butyl chloride. And I said the repulsion, steric repulsion between these methyl groups, which are on the back side of the chlorine, called B strain. Anyway, it is a steric repulsion. You need not remember B strain or back strain. So due to steric repulsion between methyl groups, the SN1 reaction is favored by tertiary butyl chloride. So that is also a driving force for SN1 reaction, tertiary butyl chloride. There is steric repulsion between methyl groups, and this causes ionization, or this favors the ionization of CCl bonds, and there is a widening of bond angle to 120 degree from 109 degree, so that the methyl groups are little more separated, so there is no chance for steric repulsion. So much about steric effect. Then we have to see one more effect called hydrogen bonding, which we will see later. Thank you.